So you feel the pressure.
That will give you NB tutorial And from then we will work from inside this directory. So in every slide, I suppose that you are already in this directory, and all commands start from there. In case it's not obvious, you are supposed to always stay there after for the duration of the. Stefan, t'as écouté?
Ouais. Yes, he said that everything is relative to the native boost folder. Huh?
Okay. So, for those of you who got the archive, you don't have to do anything there except this line.
Except which one?
So, in the archive, you already have the archive of the source code of Chipmunk. So you can open it, expand it. So I'm not sure if it's readable actually.
It is.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a readme as well.
That's it, so I cannot know, huh?
There's a readme file in the archive, so open it and follow. I put the main command lines in there.
Is a CMake supposed to be included by default? Because I had to download it.
Yeah, no, it's not there on Macs. Okay. So on Linux, it's just a apt-get CMake. Apt get install CMake or whatever. And on Mac, if you are using Mac ports or phone modes, 2 minutes to get it. So maybe I can show you in my.
No!
It's in the readme file!
Yeah, but no, we started to type, so we should see.
Okay. So just to explain, because that's a little bit important, native boost works in 32 bits only. So we have to build the library in 32 bit mode, and we have to activate conditional code to support FFI. By default, if you build Chipmunk, you don't get the FFI part. Don't spoil.
On va la réutiliser. Yeah, because you have N CD chip.
Okay. So for most nicely developed C projects, just CMake dot followed by make work, and the orange part is specific for us. So when it builds, you should have a load of.
Il n'y a pas de raison que ce soit toujours les mêmes qui soient emmerdés, quoi. Tu vois. C'est beaucoup mieux en ta vie de venir en cours.
Okay, so once you expand the archive, you get the Chipmunk directory, get into it.
Salute. Merci.
Et en fait, ça s'est fait dans un langage de merde.
Launch the build.
Bah ouais,
now Chipmunk is built, I can go back to the main directory, and from there I should be able to launch the demo project that is given with the library. And it launches, it does nice stuff. I can change demos and watch them, so it works. Which one is the nicest? Yeah, this one is good. I don't know what it
is.
Which one is that one?
I don't know, just press the letter and you get a random
one. Ah, here, okay, I found it.
Okay, so this is just to check that that Chipmunk was built successfully and it actually works.
Nice.
And you don't need to install anything globally in your system, you don't need to become root, everything stays contained. Okay?
Okay. So everybody is...
Can follow?
If you need help, you can just raise the hand.
Yeah.
He was really glad to come.
Yeah. So that's step one done.
Everybody has done the step one?
No.
So good.
No.
Where are you?
Non-Mac users.
Yeah, it will probably be a bit complicated.
Sinon, Aya, tout ce que tu fais, tu te mets avec quelqu'un qui a un Mac.
Ouais, ça marche pas. Vous mettez derrière.
Hein?
Ah oui, non, sur son PDB, ça marche pas. So next step is to get a VM for the Mac guys. It's already given in the zip. And for the image as well, everyone can use the image. It's the same for everyone. And the next step is. Yeah, just if you want to really start from scratch for a bare file image, this is the loading instructions, but we don't care for me.
So we should open sample UI.
No, there's still a step.
Ah, okay.
So then the Chipmunk library, you could have built it anywhere actually, and you need to move or make a link to the binary file of the library somewhere that the VM will find it.
Okay.
So if you're starting from the zip file, this link instruction should work. Basically, the idea is to go look for the libchipmunk.dylib in the src directory inside the sources. That's the build result. And then either you make a link to the native boost directory or you copy it or you move it.
We call that success.
Yep.
Question. The native boost, which mechanism for finding, like for library path, so does it use just the system one or the one that's bundled in?
It uses an explicit path.
The same mechanism which VM uses, which implemented in VM, but you're free to just implement your own using native.
Well, I'll explain why I'm raising the question, because I found that the sweep mechanism with all of those paths where plugins / platforms / that kind of gets in the way, and if if
it's different if you run the VM. This is for if you run the VM with a faro-ui from the command line. You double click on the Mac VM and it opens. Then you should put the link somewhere else. So it's still not really consistent
so
between
yeah,
all
that's
the VM.
Why, that's why by default it uses the VM mechanism so that you can put into like into default.
Ideally, ideally for all applications, you would install the library in the in somewhere in a global place and it would work. Okay, so once you make the link, I think it was already in the it was dead in the zip originally. And it should work now. So, yeah, this guy, if you saw before, it was red. Now it points to something current. So next step is to launch the image. That should give me a nice image that is not in demo mode. Sorry. And if I do this, yeah, you get nice animations. We are not going to start from scratch, really. Everything works already in the Faro code, and we will just play along and duplicate some of the from the of the features. That's okay for everyone. The animation.
Who did not
name the entire? Yeah, I need to change it to a Linux library name. Am I the only one using Linux?
But in the code it's delete, no?
So I need to change, right?
Because on it built with .so and so if you change the name of the link. To place the tutorial, we are all happy hacking on Faro. Yep.
Sometimes the image crash.
When doing what?
Just
nothing. CM space
no,
step. I had a cementation fault. But I have the stack in the.
No, but you know what may happen is that there is a bull that arrives at the end of the sea world. Il y a un film.
So where is the storm's author?
Yeah, that's strange. Of course, you will get sec faults, and you're at one instant, you will have the nice Faro image. You do it, and then nothing stays. But that's supposed to happen only when the code is wrong. Yeah. And I don't know from the base image.
So the error is something about.
Where is it?
It's a failure of the shipment that it says momentum of inertia must be positive and not zero. I think that there is something bug in the.
The world is flat.
The
storm is square. You know, I told you. So we should not run the demo.
Oh.
So we are all happy with Faro, but what if I told you that actually outside of the image, you've been trapped in an image and outside there is lots of interesting code. So by the way, please never use the C code on the left of the slide. This is just for fun. So we all know Faro, but what is Nautilus? And when you see the name, I don't know if it was the original intent. Nautilus, it suggests that that is purely for speed and performance. So yeah, you have Faro on top, which uses a big chunk of technology called Native Boost, which just throws native code at dirty things that you don't want to see. But no. So for this tutorial, Native Boost is fast and can be used to make things fast. But we are not really worried about this, and today we are just exploring other code outside of the image, trying to access interesting code without worrying too much about the performance. So how does Native Boost work in the system? You will know that we have an image, that the image works on top of the virtual machine, which works on top of the operating system, which works on top of silicon. In the image, the closest thing to Native Boost, or the most related thing, would be the compiler. The compiler somehow generates code that calls primitives that live in the virtual machine. And the magic link between the two is the compile method, which is an object, but it's also a special format that the VM understands and can jump into, work with. So Native Boost, it sits on top of the boundary there. And there are three parts. The Native Boost package itself, or the set of packages called Native Boost, is mostly a small talk API that represents, or that allows you to call to talk about low level stuff. So there's an interface to the VM. There's an interface to the C runtime. It allows you to build ad hoc primitives. So the way we do FFI is we will generate basically a primitive method that will call the external code that we want. And basically that means that using Native Boost, we can throw away all of the plugins and replace them with image side code, which is nice. And this part also handles the data marshalling and how to convert a small data to C data.
Is it 32 bits or?
Yeah, 32 bits at the moment. Below Native Boost, there's a...
The 32-bit part, is that simply because it's tied to COG, or is it an internal limitation of Native Boost itself?
It's an internal limitation at the moment, but just because it's at the early stages.
Oh,
and
I see.
The 64-bit
okay.
support was not done already. Mm-hmm. Actually, I'm, so yeah, the second part is a SMJIT. So SMJIT is basically an assembler. You give it, you use a Smalltalk DSL that looks like x86 assembly, and it will generate actual bytes that are executable by the CPU. So just as an aside, on this I barely started doing the ARM support in ASMJIT. My biggest achievement to date is to tell ASMG to please move constant 1 to register 1, and I get 32 bits, and they are the correct 32 bits. But so that's this kind of stuff that ASMG does. And this will help refactor a bit and insert the 64-bit support. After a while. So these two parts, Native Boost and ASMG, that's Smalltalk code, pure Smalltalk code. It lives in the image. This code needs a small part on the VM side, which is the Native Boost plugin. And basically, the Native Boost plugin is one primitive. That's not true because there are a couple others, but the main primitive that we see all the time is, here are some bytes, please do a call to it. Let's suppose it's executable code and we are just going to jump into it. Okay, so to give you the base idea, this is really the hello world of native Boost. How do we call a C function in the ideal simplest case? So it happens the ideal simplest case is to go fetch the value of an environment variable. So we do it. You can if you want. Just do an empty class and put a method in it. So the way to do the basic way to work is you go to the man page or to the documentation of your library, or you go read the code. You see, oh, there is this nice function that I would like to call. It's called getEnd. It takes a string. It returns a string. Of course, you know that strings and pointers and arrays in C are a bit of the same always. And you will basically write a simple method. So you can do it if you want to try. It's already there in the image.
I think that is due to type stuff.
So how does the primitive know the symbol name of the function?
Yeah.
How does it know that it's getEnd?
I will explain. So basically when you... that's the same code. Huh? So basically when you want to call an external function like this, on the Smalltalk side you will have a primitive method, so you often you have to do one method just for this, and then use it in your code. So the name is free. I called it getEnd with the capital, that would have been getEnvironment or whatever. We don't care. What's important is that there is a pragma identifying the native Boost primitive for calling native code. So primitive native call from the plugin native Boost plugin. And handling the error code if it's needed. So that defines a primitive an ad hoc primitive method made with native Boost. The second part, the body, is basically it works like primitive methods in like normal primitive methods. The first time that you will call getenv, it will the primitive will fail because there is no native code available. So it will execute the body, the smalltalk body, and that will generate the native code. It will change the compile method and jump into the freshly generated native code. And from there, when you call getenv, you jump directly to the native code. The primitive will succeed and call the native code. So the smalltalk body here is a description of what call we want to do. This is really the main
API for it right now, so it's just for very low level hacking.
Okay. I mean, if you know this one, you know 80%. And rest is details, I guess, if you really want to do specific stuff like loading a particular library and going to look into the symbols and whatever. So the syntax for the smalltalk body is, so it's a message called nbcall module. The argument to nbcall is a literal array that looks very much like the C signature of the function. You could copy paste, but Igor will kill me if I say that.
Yeah.
So it's not really a copy paste because we change char star by string, char star by string. You adapt it a bit to say how to map the C, how you want to interpret the C, the smalltalk object into C values.
So the little remark here that you can use actually the argument to nbcall, you can use string. Instead of using literal array, you can use string, but I prefer literal array that you can then use the IDE, like you can look for the senders and that you can have some.
Basically, there is a little nbcall that parses whatever you pass as an argument, and it will guess what the calling convention is. So yeah, inside these signatures, the name of the argument, you can use arguments from your smalltalk pattern, from the method pattern. You can use self as well. In some cases. And for the type of the return type and the type of the argument, this will define the marshalling policy. So in C it was a char star and we said we want smalltalk strings in and out of the function. And the last part is you're saying which library you want to look for the symbol. And this one is a particular case because that's the C library that is always there. And you could pass the name of a chipmunk.dylib there, and it would look for getenv in chipmunk.dylib.
What C library is it?
That's
Libc. Smalltalk speaking, is it a global name? Or?
Yeah, I think it's a constant or a class variable that contains zero, and zero is a magical value. That's what we really don't care. This is the special case for native books. Usually, you pass a string which is the name of the language, the .so or the .dlib that you want.
Yeah, you need to be careful with those magic values because not on all platforms zeros are invalid.
Yeah. Go beat Igor with this. I have no clue why it's zero. I just did print it and. Okay, so the next step is that works, but it's really the simplest example. So the next step is we are going to use chipmunk.
Waking Mars.
Super.
So I encourage you to go and open this link. You just Google for chimpanzee physics and click on the documentation link on their homepage. Okay. So I still need to explain a bit how chipmunk works, so you understand what we do next. So it's a physics simulation library for 2D games, and it handles only the physics simulation. There is no graphics involved, no nothing. So for doing the graphics, we have a little bit of a small code that is called Storm, and that uses Athens to do the drawing on screen. So that's what you saw with the balls bouncing. That's Storm, a little small Storm game, and Athens working. So this is a quite long page, but it has most of the interesting information. Now I will go a bit through the basic concepts of chipmunk. The four main objects that are interesting are the rigid bodies, the shapes, which are separate from the bodies, constraints between bodies, physical like springs and so on, and simulation space, which is basically the simulation itself, the container for the simulation. Of course, there are some other things, like vectors, bounding boxes, and mathematical functions to compute stuff, but that's really on the side. So what is a rigid body for chipmunk? It's basically just a center of gravity, a point, a position in space, that has a mass, that has an inertia, a velocity, and an angular velocity, or rotational velocity. And it's a purely abstract body, there is no volume, there is no surface, there is no nothing, it's just a point mass in space. So if you want to go peek at the source code, the definition is in code cpbody.h. There. Attached to the bodies, to the rigid bodies, there are collision shapes. So the shapes, they are there to describe the outer shape of a body. And you can attach, you have basic shapes like circles and boxes and segments and whatever. And you can attach as many shapes to one body as you want, if you want to do complex shapes. So they describe the outer surface, and so they have properties of friction, of bounciness, and so on. And the system will detect collisions, contacts, based on these shapes. So you could have, it doesn't matter if this is the visual shape that you see. I mean, if you have a person, a character in a game, it could be just a square, the shape, or a ball. And this is defined in CP shape and CP poly shape, in the source code. The last one, I think I'm passing on the constraints. So there is the concept of a simulation space, which is just a container. You make a simulation space, you add bodies and you can add shapes also in it, and constraints between bodies into the simulation space. You set global properties like how strong is the gravity and is there wind friction and whatever. You put walls and static stuff and you have your simulation. The last one is constraints, but we are not going to look a lot to them. Constraints, they link two rigid bodies and they say, well, there is a spring or there is a pivot point, or those two bodies are linked rigidly together, or something. If you go through the docs, it's not really interesting for today, but they are based on synchronizing velocities. It's a bit approximate, it's not really physically accurate, physical simulation, but it works for games. And for the curious, they had to do something of an instance and class system, because a constraint links a body A and B, and then it has a type that defines how forces and velocities will be transferred between the two bodies. So that was fun to find this one. Okay, so now we are going to look a bit around the Smalltalk code. So in the image, you should have a browser where I did groups already, so you have a focus on the interesting code. And if you go look to the CM space class and the addBody method, which of course, so if I go to the browser, and
Storm2D chipmunk.
Yeah, Storm2D chipmunk, CP space, and the first one is addBody. CM space.
CM space.
Yeah, the names are different between Smalltalk and C, so I always mix it. So you see that this is a native boost method using the native boost primitive and doing a call, a native boost call to a function that's called CP space add body, passing itself as the first argument and then passing the body argument as the second one. So basically this is a this is an accessor in the C code. Yes. And there you can see, just before I showed you this version with NB code and module.
It's now gone.
And the module part is now gone, so how does Native Boost do to guess magically which library to use? Maybe. 2 minutes, which are short 2 minutes.
So it is not on the class side.
It's in the trait.
So wait.
Don't spoil the fun.
Aha. Just monk library.
The trait.
Yeah. Mm. So even 1 minute was too long.
Yeah. T chipmunk library.
So where is it?
T-chipmunk library.
So you could have gone to nbcall and inspected the code and seen that it tries to resolve a library in some way. But just looking at the whole of Storm, there is strangely a trait in the code, this one, which defines you have an instance style method that calls the class side one, and the class side one returns libchipmunk. So this is automatically, as long as you have this NB library name or handle method defined, all NB calls will default to the result of this. And this one, I guess it just returns a string, but it could try to look up and do intelligent stuff there. So basically,
it was
done in a thread, because often you have two or three classes that need to do native calls to the same library, and that way you share everything. You share this definition in all the different places. So another
step
is the physics simulation. It works step by step, so you have a loop, and the simulation engine will compute what happens at each step of the loop. So in the Smalltalk part, this is shown by a step method which takes a number which is the number of milliseconds that passed since the previous step, I think, from memory. And of this one is calling the primitive one, and the primitive one, it expects a time value, and it will do a native call to a function that returns nothing. It's called cp space step. And once a cp float argument in the second place. Yeah.
What was self?
Self is the cf space instance. So it will convert back to the cp space, the C structure, the data structure that you did.
What is cp float? It will be explained later.
So the question is, you have the float, the small talk float, which has a small talk specific format, of course. And on the C side, you have some type def actually, that is named the cp float. So on the C side, if you will go and see,
achievement types. Go to chipmunk types. Chipmunk underscore types. It's there.
Yeah. Okay, so then that's
the first thing which you need. No, what because what is the primitive C type you do in this? Because if you have
so that's a usual thing in C to define different names for the basic types, just in case you change your mind and want to have a bigger float or something. So they did a type def named CP float for the double or float or whatever. They need on this platform, and it's in the middle of a conditional code for platform support.
Okay.
Okay.
So where do we define that?
So where do we define it? This is always the same. So.
Where is this? The CM types.
To be honest, I am not really completely clear how this works, because there is a resolution mechanism, but in the end, it falls back to